This morning we're going to talk about, obviously, hardening mobile apps, primarily iOS. The principles we'll talk about would be applicable in Android and other platforms, but certainly the specifics when you get into this low level of stuff are very, very different. But we're going to talk about some of the problem space with the mobile app environment that we have today, as well as how we can make our applications a whole lot more resilient to attack. I have for you here some really, really worthwhile, and I'll make the slides available for the class, of course, but some very useful tools that, or reading material if you want to take these concepts further. Strongly recommend Jonathan Jarski's book at the top there, Hacking and Securing iOS Applications. It's a little bit dated. He wrote it regarding iOS 5, and we're up to iOS 9 now, obviously. So it's a couple of years old, but he presents the concepts extremely well. Strongly recommend that. And not the specifics haven't changed so much from then that it's not useful. So it's still a worthwhile book. And the most recent one is this one down here, Learning iOS Penetration Testing. You will learn a great deal from that book. It's very technical. It's not as well presented in terms of narrative as Jarski's book is. So the two books go very well together. I was actually one of the tech reviewers of the bottom ones, but don't let that stop you. It's a really good book. I strongly recommend it. It's not very expensive. You can find it on Amazon, and it's available in a Kindle electronic format. So having it in electronic format allows you to search and cut and paste examples and stuff. So very worthwhile resources to take a look at if you want to take these concepts that we'll talk about further. So as I said, we're going to talk about some of the problem space. I'll talk about how people attack applications on iOS, and you guys can do this, not in this class, you won't have time now, but you can do all the same stuff that I'm doing here. I'll be demoing it up here on the screen for the most part, talking about the tools that I use. If you have questions about how to find those tools or how to get them working, feel free to email me, contact me on Twitter, wherever, and I'd be happy to help you through that. There's some really, really neat and interesting stuff that we can do in penetration testing or attacking an iOS application specifically. And then we'll take, with that understanding, we're going to focus on how to harden our applications. Turns out, I'll give you the spoiler, an application in iOS is about as secure as JavaScript in a browser. If you think, oh, well, it's compiled, it's going to behave the way I wrote it, you're living in a dream world. Turns out that iOS, or Objective-C in particular, is a lot softer than that. So you have to go to great lengths to make your application reasonably resilient, and even then it's not perfect. So we'll talk about that. So first thing, over the years, Apple has done, in my view, a pretty darn good job at iteratively improving the security of the platform. I remember in the early versions of iOS, you could plug a USB cable in, you could mount the file system and get to all sorts of files on an iPhone or an iPad. That has largely changed over time, and it's gotten a lot better from a security and privacy standpoint. Nowadays, if you have a modern iPhone 6, iPhone 6 Plus, and you're using a strong passcode with Touch ID, if you lose that device, you know, take that device and throw it over the wall at your worst competitor or your worst adversary, you can have a lot of confidence that they're not going to get the information off of that system. But that has been an iterative process. So let's talk about some of the things they've put in place inside the OS in particular. So the first thing they started doing, and they, even in the very first version of the iPhone, anybody remember 2007? You know, it wasn't all that long ago. The very first version of the iPhone, they started by trying to reduce the attack surface of the device quite a lot, right? So we're starting basically with Unix, with a stripped down version of Mac OS, the same Darwin kernel, it's Unix under the hood, but they still drastically reduced the attack surface. For example, it didn't have a normal shell. You couldn't just open up a terminal window. It wasn't a general purpose desktop computing platform. It was a mobile phone, and for all intents and purposes, a normal user wouldn't even know that Unix was inside it. But our adversaries figured that out pretty quickly. So some of the things that they've started to do, privilege separation happened early on. So even though every process runs as root, which seems to contradict this, they actually separate the processes pretty well. So every process runs with UID 0, but they're using a bunch of kernel extensions from SE Linux that were developed at NSA, and you can trust that or not trust that, that's up to you. But processes shouldn't be able to poke at one another, right? Just because you're in a process space over here doesn't mean you can touch the memory from a process over here all that easily. So, and they really tried to separate things pretty much, and reasonably well. Code signing has been there almost from day one. Basically, the iOS is a hierarchical chain of digital signatures. Everything starting with the bootloader. Before it's loaded and executed, they check a signature. Is it signed by Apple? So they have tamper-evident, not resistant, tamper-evident seals on everything they do. Before they load a piece of code, they make sure that the tamper-evident seal hasn't been broken, and then they load it and run it. And that pretty much permeates everything, even down to the applications, right? So, or up to the applications, however you want to look at it. Everything that's loaded is checked. And that actually has served them pretty well. The entire ecosystem is also very closed, right? So it is formidably difficult to take an application like off of the internet and install it on your device. It's not a general purpose platform. It has to go through Apple's process. Next, I think it was around, I think it was the iPhone 3GS or the 4 that started to, when they started to introduce data execution prevention. I believe that was iOS 3 or 4. Don't quote me on the numbers, and it doesn't much matter anymore. But they started to do data execution prevention. So you could take a block of memory, for example, maybe your stack or your heap, and you could say, this is non-executable memory. And then even if somebody was able to do like a buffer overflow attack and change your instruction pointer to point the CPU at the data in the stack, it wouldn't run because it has the no execute or the do not execute bit on. So that actually turned out to be pretty good. However, even if we're protecting data from being executed, that does not prevent all buffer overflow attacks from being successful. Because our adversaries, okay, now they can't put code directly into the stack through a buffer overflow attack. So what? What we can do is we can still change the instruction pointer. And by pointing to code that's already in memory, we can get things to run. Because from the stack, the way the instruction pointer works is we're going to call an address in memory. And when that hits a return, we're going to come back to where we were. So you can still manipulate a buffer overflow attack even if you can't get code into the stack space. If you know where to find the code that you want to run, it has to already be in memory. So the next thing they did is address space layout randomization, which means that, all right, I can still change the instruction pointer and get it to run some other address, but if I don't know what address to run, it's not too useful for me. So they've slowly, and this is like one iOS version at a time, they've slowly made it increasingly difficult to do traditional buffer overrun type attacks and things like that. So that has meant that people trying to jailbreak the device, for example, every time a new iOS comes out, it takes them longer and longer to put together a successful jailbreak. If one of the things I've watched over the years is new iOS comes out, let's watch the jailbreak community. And it used to be like 2 days and boom, we've got a jailbreak for iOS 2, you know. And now iOS 9.2.1 came out essentially over Christmas time. It was released into the beta community and then out to the public in early January. We still don't have a successful jailbreak for it. And I know that people are working on that. And some people say, oh, I have one working, but they're not releasing it. So who knows? But still, all of these things have made it more and more difficult to jailbreak or to attack applications. Starting to sound optimistic, right? Hold on. Now, the Objective-C runtime, this is the part that absolutely kills me. So, and that's an actual photo of a truck in my neighborhood, by the way. I hope you see what's wrong with that. So, Sevis. I laughed very hard when I saw that. Anyway, Objective-C. Right, so let's compare C and Objective-C. Objective-C is a superset of C. The way C works is when you need to do something with, say, a subroutine or an operating system call, it is, in fact, a call. So our CPU points to a different address, it runs some stuff, it returns and comes back and continues on. Objective-C works differently than that, right? In Objective-C, our methods aren't called, they're allocated in memory and messages are passed to them. Well, how does that work at a CPU level? It turns out that at an actual machine language level, calls are still made. You know, you don't really see that, but it's happening. And that impacts us greatly. You'll see why as we go on here. So underneath that object-oriented facade, it's still running on a 386 sort of architecture CPU, at least for all intents and purposes. That means that there's a lot of tampering that we can do. We can eavesdrop on the message traffic. We can inject messages. We can watch calls, all sorts of stuff, as you'll see as we go along here. So the underbelly of our environment, our platform, has some very fundamental flaws in it. Even if it were written entirely in C, if you're on the platform, there's a heck of a lot that we can do. So there's some serious problems in the way our operating system and our application space works. That's great for us if we're going to do testing of it. Not so great for the developers. So the biggest things I worry about, why does this matter? Because with the sort of thing I'm talking about is poking around in my own process space. What does that buy me if I were your adversary? So I worry about lost and stolen devices. I worry about people getting personal data off of a phone. But really, that's not a big concern anymore. What bothers me the most about that weak underbelly in Objective-C, what bothers me the most is when you release your application out to the App Store, your adversary can install that on his or her device, and they have all the time in the world to poke at it and prod at it and try to break it and see what they can learn from it. Now, I don't care. You know, they're not going to get data off of a device. Like, I pick on United Airlines a lot. I fly in United a lot, and I can put the United app on my phone, and I can get to data inside that app, but who cares? The reason I care is if I can take a look at your app and learn its architecture and find the weaknesses in your design especially, now I can potentially exploit and affect a much larger community. I can affect United Airlines, or I could affect any app for that matter. I pick on United, but it could be anybody. So I worry about people reverse engineering apps and finding weaknesses that can be exploited, not just locally on one device, but potentially across a large community. So those are the things that we worry about. And there's actually not a lot that we can do to stop that, right? to do the reverse engineering, our attacker wants to learn about how the app works. They want to poke at it and prod at it. They want to tamper with the runtime environment, all for the purpose of finding flaws or weaknesses that can be exploited. When I see, for example, that you have implemented a control on the client side, woohoo, because you can tamper with anything on the client side. So I look for mistakes in your thinking, and it's primarily design problems that I look for. Implementation problems might come up, but with implementation bugs, like, oh, I don't know, SQL injection or something, the exploits are typically client-side and they don't buy me much. But when I find an architectural weakness, now I can do something with it. So how are we going to do that? You know, the environment is pretty tightly closed. If I look at my iPhone 6 here, there's not a heck of a lot that I can do with that as an attacker. But when I look at my old trusty but rusty iPhone 4, I can jailbreak this guy and use it for testing your applications. In fact, I keep a couple of retired iPhones with different versions of the operating system and different levels of jailbreak. I'll talk about that in a little bit more. But this stuff is pretty easy to do. So some of the tools that you're going to need to do this. You need a jailbroken device. I should caution you that jailbreaking is not for the faint of heart. It's a fickle thing. The iOS 9.2.1 currently doesn't have a readily available jailbreak, for example. 9.2 and 9.1 do, but I can't go and install 9.2 or 9.1 on a device any longer because Apple won't sign it. So what I do is I keep several iPhones that I used to use. I'll put a version of the operating system on it, and I wait. I wait for a jailbreak to come out for that version of the operating system. This one has 9.2.1 on it. It's not yet jailbroken. But as soon as the jailbreak comes out for 9.2.1, I'm going to put it on here. In the meantime, I don't run updates on it, right? So you really don't want to do this on your primary phone. really don't want to do this on your primary phone. I strongly encourage you to think through those words very carefully. But doing it on a test phone like this works great. And I'll install the apps that I want to test on here. And some app, sometimes after you've jailbroken, installing an app is not as easy as before you've jailbroken. We'll get to that. But you really, really want a jailbroken device to do this. I used to be very much not in favor of jailbreaking, and I still am for production purposes, but for testing purposes, it is absolutely vital. You also want some tools. So Cydia is one of the big popular jailbreak tools. It is basically, think of it as an underground version of the App Store. It uses the Debian apt package management system from Debian Linux, apt-get update, apt-get install, you know, whatever. And it gives you a nice GUI front end. So you can go out to this application store, pick the tools that you want, install them, and it manages them, it keeps them updated and trustworthy, I'm sure. You can install a lot of stuff with Cydia, and it gives you access to all sorts of goodies. It comes with most jailbreaks, including the one from Evasion and all the other jailbreak tools. The vast majority of publicly available jailbreaks, when you install the jailbreak, you get a copy of Cydia. So Cydia is awesome. Once you have that in, you're going to go out and you're going to get OpenSSH, install that on your device. And just like SSH on any Unix or Windows machine, you can now SSH into your iPhone and get a shell prompt on it. And that's where the fun stuff happens, right? So you really, really, really want OpenSSH on your jailbroken device for this. Word of caution, when you do this, you have literally opened up your device to root access shell prompts using a default password of Alpine. What's the very first thing you're going to do when you log in?
Change the password.
Change the password. Right. Seriously, change the password. Everyone in the world knows that the default password is Alpine. The malicious software that we have seen in the iOS world has 99% been on jailbroken devices, and the stuff that propagates requires the default password of Alpine. And yet, a lot of people don't know to change that. But you guys are smarter than that. It's not going to happen to you. I also strongly suggest when you're doing this kind of testing, do it on a private network. Like, don't do it on the faculty club network. Do it on your own Wi-Fi in your lab. But nonetheless, you still want to change that default password. Alpine to something else. I don't care what it is. You also want a debugger. I will warn you and show you the value of the debugger ebbs and flows over time. Basically, it comes down to whether or not you have a symbol table available to you or not. But the debugger works, and you want the GNU debugger in there. Then you want this one, CyCrypt. You'll see that. I'll show you a demo of that in a little while. CyCrypt is one of the most awesome tools for testing an application. It quite possibly, it's the most fun you can lawfully have with your pants on. You can do some really, really cool stuff with CyCrypt, and you'll see. I call it a man-in-the-app attack. It lets you get inside the app and poke at it and using some very high-level tools. once you have those tools ready, let's talk about a couple of techniques that we're going to use to do our analysis. We're going to use static analysis. We're going to take a look at a binary, for example, an executable file. We're going to do some static analysis of that file and try to learn from it. Turns out that our executable files will typically tell us a lot about the application. It'll tell us all the object names. It'll tell us the interfaces, the methods, and all sorts of stuff like that. We also want to do dynamic analysis, and that's where things get kind of fun. We can watch the app work and watch its behavior. And then we also want to do active tampering in the runtime environment. And the difference between these two, they're both forms of dynamic analysis. I view this, the traditional dynamic analysis, as more observing, and this is active tampering. And so we can do both of those, and they both help us in different ways. So let's step through a few of those. We can take an executable, and we can use a couple of readily and freely available tools to take a look and learn from that executable. So let me show you a couple of things. I'm going to switch back and forth from the slides to a shell screen. Can everybody in the back of the room read this clearly? All right. So I have up here, my iPhone 6 is running a hotspot, and my Mac and my jailbroken device are all connected to that hotspot. It's a private network. I'm doing this on, not on the faculty club network. And as such, my jailbroken device has an IP number associated with it on my private network. So first thing I'm going to do let's just make sure that it's out there. So there's my my iPhone. I can ping it. I can log in as root. Using a password other than Alpine. The system name is guest bedroom, ignore that. This machine actually is gainfully employed when I'm home. It runs an audio application, so it behaves like a speaker on my network at home. But other than that, I'm now on my iPhone. So I'm on an iPhone 3.1 architecture, Darwin kernel, such and such. It is a Unix shell environment, and it behaves a lot like running a traditional bash shell system on a Unix machine, on a traditional Unix machine. So almost everything I can do now. There's a lot of commands that aren't here, but almost all my command line stuff on Unix I have available to me here, and it's actually pretty responsive. You know, for a tiny little device like this, it runs about as fast as the mainframe Unix systems that I'm familiar to from the distant past. So, all right, so we can take a look at what's there. I have the large part of my file system is down under private var, and it's a 16 gig device, and almost all of that is unused on this system. So let's go down there. So private var mobile is actually where a lot of the interesting stuff is installed. You see there under applications, for example, that's an application folder just like you would have on a regular Mac OS X. We have file name completion just like we have in normal bash. It is a proper shell environment. So when I look around here, oops, it doesn't look at all like an application folder from a traditional Mac OS X, does it? All the directory names are these big, long, random strings of foo. So where is everything? So one of the things you'll quickly find out is that Apple obfuscates things, right? They have their applications installed in areas that are non-predictable. In fact, if I take, I have two applications in particular loaded on this device. If I unload that application and load it again, the folder name changes. It is a derived folder name, and it's random, and that's part of the way that they enforce the sandboxing. So if I install my application on somebody else's iPhone, if my application tries to read something in a static directory name, it's not going to find it because it's in a different location. So that's part of how they separate processes, right? Obfuscation, but you know, it works. However, turns out, I can look at things in reverse order or in time sorted order, and there's two folders at the top there where I've installed some stuff on here. So let's go, I know which one it is, I'm going to go into the second folder, and thank goodness for file name completion. You don't have to type those things. So now I'm in a folder that contains an app called iGoat. I know that because there's a package folder here called iGoat.app. So I'm going to go in there. I'm inside the application here, just in its storage space. In there, I'll find a file here called iGoat. I want to copy that file. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to make, I'm going to print out the folder that I'm in. Then I'm going to open up another terminal session. I'm going to go over here and I'm going to grab that folder name, if I can find my mouse. Let me just pull this over to my screen for just a second so I can see what I'm doing. All right, so what I've done is I've copied that long folder name, again, trying to limit human typing, things like that. So now I'm over back on my Mac. I'm going to CD to desktop. Oops. I've created a folder here called foo, where I'm going to copy things into. So I'm going to use SCP using SSH protocol. I'm going to copy using the root account at 172.20.10.3:. Here's my file name, and I'm going to copy slash igoat to here. No such file or directory. What did I do wrong? No, it is iGoat. So let me just make sure I... I didn't include the folder name. So yes, igoat.app for the folder name, and then igoat. Yeah, you have to keep typing in the password, and that's a pain in the rear, but who cares? It's not Alpine. All right, so now I have that executable. I have that executable file down here on my Mac. And I can do things with it. And you're probably thinking, well, if I put an app in the App Store, it's going to be encrypted. And I'll talk about that in a minute. But basically, no, it's not all that well encrypted. I can get to it anyway. But I'll explain how I'll do that later. This is an app that I've compiled and installed, and it is not encrypted. It has not gone through the Apple Store. So it's an unencrypted app. Nonetheless, assume that your app in the App Store will be in this same state. And it's trivial to get it into this state. So what is this state? So file igoat, it is a mock executable image. What can I do with it? Let's take a look. OTool is a neat little tool. This shows me all the libraries that you linked with in order to build your application. In particular, this little guy down here, lib Objective-C, dynamic library, that says to me, aha, it's an Objective-C target. That's cool. I can play with that. So there's other things there that I use, but when you see lib Objective-C, you know that you're going to have a pretty easy time of things usually. So that's cool. I can also, and these are all in the slides, so don't bother with writing this all down. If I use otool-lowercase-l, it gives me specifics in terms of addresses, offsets, sizes of blocks of memory, and things like that, things that are useful to me in other ways. Another one that I like, this is a public domain tool, but it's not installed by Xcode. You have to go get a copy of it. So I have it in my personal applications folder. It's called class dump z of igoat. This shows me some really cool stuff about your application. It shows me all of your objects and all of the interfaces to the objects and all the types for those things. So I have a Boolean function and so on and so forth for different parts of my application. This is the map that I want to attack your application. So it shows me what's there. It shows me the interfaces that you have. This is static analysis, and things can change during runtime. But so this is a static view of that application as it is right now. Cool stuff, though, right? All of that stuff that you think is hidden inside your compiled application turns out to not be so hidden, and I can see this stuff. So another one that I like a lot. This one shows me all of the calls that are actually in your application, what library functions they're calling. You're using SQLite, obviously, some Objective-C stuff, some pretty cool static stuff about your application. And I'm going to log all this stuff. I'm going to put it into a file, I'm going to remember it, and I'm going to come back to that later on and use that against your application. So, underneath all this, as I said, even though we're running a really cool object-oriented environment, it's Objective-C after all, underneath all that, there's a sleight of hand that goes on. You have these objects, you have traditional small talk-like neat stuff that we can do, but when it's actually running, it really is C. You just don't see that, as I said. The key things that run, though, that matter to us are there are calls whenever you are sending and receiving messages between objects. Underneath that, there's a call to a C library function called Objective-C message send, Objective-C get class, and there's a few others. So we can see messages being transferred if we trap those calls. How do we do that? We do that in the debugger. We can we'll talk about that dynamically, but those are the calls that I worry about, and we can see all those things happening dynamically. So, and as I said, this worked with encrypted binaries as well. If I was looking at a commercial application like United Airlines or some banking application, whatever, I get it off of the App Store, I install it on my device, I jailbreak my device. Chances are that application will not be able to detect that it's running on a jailbroken device, and if it is, I can lie to it, we'll get to that later, and it'll now not know that it's on a jailbroken device. But the cool thing about encrypting applications is that encrypted applications don't run, right? So something has to decrypt them before they can run. So rather than trying to decrypt the application, I'm going to let the operating system do that for me. I'm going to load it into memory, and then I'm going to read the blocks of memory after they've been decrypted, and I'm going to store those into a file, and I'm going to decrypt your app. I have to know where all of your stuff resides in memory, how big those blocks are, and so on and so forth. Sounds like a lot of work, but go out to Cydia, there's tools that'll do that for you. So I can very trivially, in a matter of minutes, use publicly available tools, load your encrypted app, decrypt it in memory, store it into a perfectly executable, unencrypted file, copy it over to my machine, and analyze it just like I do with IGO. So your protections in terms of encryption in the App Store, ignore those. They're useful for all sorts of things, but not from reverse engineering. They do not stop an even novice level reverse engineer from getting into your app. So we can analyze those too. I've already shown you some things, and I'll show you some other things here. The next step that we want to explore is dynamic analysis, and we can do different things depending on what we want to observe. So the tools that I like a lot are the debugger, of course. We can watch things in memory, and Scrypt. We'll get to that in a few minutes. But so we can load something and observe it. This is no different than what you might do with a compiled C application on a Mac. We can put it into the debugger and watch it. The things in particular that are of interest to me, a few slides back I showed you those library calls for the Objective-C messaging. I can watch those, and I'll show you here in a second. So we can also actively tamper with a running application, and I'll show you how to do that as well in a few seconds. The tools that we want for these, I already showed you a couple of these, but the GNU debugger, Scrypt. We can also watch things at a network level. Now, I'm not going to focus much on the network level stuff in this class, but that's also pretty easy to set up. We can You saw on Monday one of the sessions on bug bounty stuff. We can watch an application, even SSL communications in most cases, we can watch that going through the network and we can tamper with that. That's not my main focus here. I'm mainly focusing inside the process space, but we can do that as well. So first thing, and I will warn you, remember I said that jailbreaks are fickle. The jailbreak that I currently have on this device that I'm using is in iOS 7. I do not have all the symbol tables, so this step is a little bit more complicated, but it can still be done. So what I want to do, if I have a jailbreak that has all the symbol tables on it, I can load a process by its process ID. So I take my target application, I load it into memory, I look at the process table, I find its process ID, I can attach to that running process with the GNU debugger, and I can set a breakpoint. Every time you call object message send, I can set a breakpoint there. My difficulty with this device is I don't know where object message send is because the symbol table isn't there. But it's in memory. If I go poking for it, I can find it, and that's just a memory address. So I can't live demo this one without finding where that is, and that's going to take a long time. So, but I can set a breakpoint at this address space, and one of the cool things about GNU debugger is I can build these macros. So I can give it a series of commands. When this break occurs, run these commands, examine register 0, examine register 1, and these are the data types that I want to view. And this is basically a CPU sniffer at that point. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to run my application, and this means continue. So what I would do is I'm going to run my application with my debug session going into a file. And I'm just going to step through using that application. Every single time the application sends a message between objects, that goes into the file that I'm storing here. And I have a complete, basically, log file of every message between every object. And it gets big very quickly, but now I can eavesdrop on your application. This is static, not static, this is passive dynamic analysis. So I'm observing your application, but I'm not changing the way it works. But this turns out to be very easy if you have the symbol table. And my previous jailbreak had that, and it worked beautifully. Hopefully my next one will on this device as well. But this works very well in most cases. Then advance over here to CyCrypt. This is where things are particularly fun. CyCrypt, when I found this, I was like a kid in a candy shop. This is just one of the coolest tools. So it allows developers to explore and modify running applications. Also works on OS X, by the way. So on iOS in particular, this is the cool part. It uses a hybrid of Objective-C and JavaScript syntax. So what it gives me is a command shell, a CyCrypt command shell. I can type in JavaScript / Objective-C syntax that it understands, and there's how-to documents, there's primers on this, I don't know if there's any books on CyCrypt, but you go out to secappdev.org and you can learn a great deal about how to use it. It is an absolutely awesome little utility. So let me show you some of the stuff that we can do with CyCrypt. First, we have to go back to our iPhone. So I'm still logged in there, right? I'm going to run CyCrypt. So you can see I'm still on my iPhone. I'm going to stay in this folder. But anyway, just run CyCrypt by itself. I get a CyCrypt prompt without attaching to any application. Let's take a quick look and see some of the stuff that we can do there. So I'm going to type in a quick hello world in this. I'm going to basically build an application in Objective-C, very simple one, and run it from memory. So var All right, so this is a one-line, very simple little Objective-C program that I typed in wrong. I'm missing an angle bracket. Fortunately, you have command line editing here. All right, there we go. So I've created a new object in memory called MyString. It is of type NSString. Anybody know what NS stands for? And these are most of the core objects in iOS. Almost all of them, the names begin with NS. What's the name? Bonus points if you know what NS means. Next step. Yeah. Old software never dies. Remember that. Next step was Steve Jobs' company before he came back to Apple, and they did some really cool stuff there, but the object names in Next Step have carried forward and we're still using them today. That's what the NS stands for. So I've created this object called MyString. It is an NS string object. I'm going to allocate it in memory, and I'm going to initialize it with a string of hello world. So there's this object that's now in memory called MyString. What can I do with that? I can send it a message. Hey MyString, tell me your length. That's a standard method for strings. And it tells me it's a length 11. So I can interrogate it, I can talk to it, I can send it messages. If it had various different methods, interfaces, I can just type them in and send it to them. All right? So I am interacting dynamically, typing a command in Objective-C and sending it to that object. So I can change that to hello cruel. Pretend I spelled it right. And then I send it a message, and you'll notice the result is now 19. You know, it's a different object in memory. So that's just a real quick glimpse as to the syntax of what you have here available in CyCrypt. Where it gets really cool is when you can attach to a running application. So I'm on this iPhone. I am going to load Safari. You guys know what Safari is, right? I'm loading up Safari, and my default URL that I'm connecting to through my hotspot is CNN.com. So it's a news site. I'm connecting to CNN, and there you see Hillary Clinton's smiling face, right? So Clinton mocks Trump. So I'm looking at CNN. I want to tamper with that Safari interface, but I want to do it from inside the application. I'm not going to use the user interface here, right? So set that iPhone over there. Back over here in my shell space. I'm going to type PS. You'll notice things aren't quite as zippy fast as they were before. Oops. Oh, I'm still in CyCrypt, sorry. PSAX, come on. There must be a lot of JavaScript crud running on CNN.com. Can't imagine. Come on. There we go. This is what Unix used to look like. Especially on shared mainframes. You had to be patient. All right, so here's my process table. What I'm specifically looking for is Safari. So mobile applications, that's not it. Anybody see my Safari process here? I don't see it. So let me pull that over to my screen for just a second so I can find where Safari actually is. This is my private frameworks, mobile applications. This one has got to be, that could be it. That could be Safari. That's not the folder where my stuff is. So that probably is it. It's truncating the screen. So what I would normally do is make the font size a lot smaller so I can see what's going on my screen. I'm going to assume that this is the Safari process right now and that 397 is my process ID. So let's attach to that and hope for the best. So CyCrypt dash P for process, and 397. And I'm going to put it up on the top of the screen here so you guys can read it in the back of the room. Come on. That's very slow, and it's not usually that bad. Darn Hillary. I'll tell you what, let me go to a simpler page. I'm going to Wikipedia instead. I'm assuming that there's a lot less crud running in Wikipedia. All right, so there's the Wikipedia screen. I know you guys can't see this in the back of the room, but I am on the Wikipedia page loading up, right? Session. Let's go back then to my iPhone. I'm going to step away from the live demo for just a second. I will try to fix that. But in the meantime, this is what I would do. We grab that running process. The first thing you have to do is you create an object for that process that you just grabbed. Because inside of CyCrypt, just an internal thing and the way it works, you've attached to that process, but you don't have an object that you can communicate with. So there's an internal object type called UI application. So the first thing I always do when I grab a process is I create an object. In my case, I call it app, and I grab the application that I'm watching. Now I can manipulate that application, and if my demo was working, I can send the app the following message, open URL, and I'm giving it a URL string, initializing it with www.secappdev.org, and you would see Safari go to secappdev.org. And so anything you can do, if you understand how the objects are working and how they're laid out, you can send those messages, get those commands in exactly as though you've just typed that in yourself. So anything like input validation that might exist, you can bypass that. Any object that has methods that you wouldn't normally get to as a user, you can get directly to them here. You can also do things like there are individual data fields, like this is a Boolean data field called network activity indicator visible. If I set that to be true or yes, you'll notice on the screen, which you can't right now, but you would notice on the screen the little network activity bar that spins around, that would start spinning. I changed that to no and it stops spinning. You have complete dynamic tampering ability with everything running inside that application. I'd be happy to show anybody that offline. When it's not in live demo mode, it works beautifully, by the way. But computers could always detect that. But anyway, that's what I can do with this. It's a very, very powerful tool. One of the other things that I love doing with this, if I'm looking at a specific application, I load the application just like I just did with Safari. I build a function. You know, this is a JavaScript / Objective-C syntax that CyCrypt gives us. So I'm going to create a function. I'm going to call it app.ls. And I'm going to give it a parameter, whatever that parameter is, and I'm basically just iterating through all the objects of that application, and I'm telling them to tell me what they are. So this is a way of enumerating dynamically all the objects in a particular application that you've attached to. And then I simply say app ls to and point it to my object. So if I've attached to Safari, and I've created that object called app. What I'll do is I type in this function or cut and paste in this function, and I say app ls app. And it will go out to Safari and say, hey Safari, tell me all your objects and methods. And you use the application to enumerate itself. all of the objects. It recurses through all of the objects, and each one of them reports back and says, I am object authenticator. I have the following methods. And it tells you what's there. Isn't that cool? Now, how does that make you feel about your application? That gets us into the next part. How do we harden these things? Knowing that your application client side is not trustworthy. It is no more trustworthy than JavaScript running in a browser. And we know that we can tamper with anything in JavaScript. It's a really cool language, but if you put it in a browser, it's going to be tampered with. Objective-C, it's a really cool language, but if you put it on a mobile device, it's going to be tampered with. So you can't trust what's on the client, period. How do we build a trustworthy application if we can't trust the client side? And factor in also that your adversary can tamper with and eavesdrop on all of your network traffic in all likelihood. If you're doing certificate pinning, it ratchets the difficulty up a bit, but as we saw in the bug bounty session earlier this week, you can get past that as well. So, all of that tampering, we can do some horrible things with it, and we can take that a step farther, in fact. We can replace existing methods, right? So if I have a call to an address for a particular library, I can change that address in memory. I can't change it in your executable because then the executable is no longer signed or the signature will break. So if I go and tamper with an executable, it won't work, but I can tamper with it in memory. So if you're calling a library or talking to an object, I can change what you're talking to. Or I can change the dynamic libraries that you're loading. I can point it to different libraries. So that entire world has some serious problems with it. nothing is what it appears. There is a tool, and I didn't really talk about it much here. There is a tool called Cydia Substrate that automates this process. So with Cydia Substrate, you can tell it, use this library, for example. I don't want you to use the standard Objective-C library. I want you to use this library. You can change the world so that when an application, for example, you've written a banking application, the first thing that it does is it checks to see if it's running on a jailbroken device. One of the most common things to do to see if you're running on a jailbroken device is check to see if somebody has installed Cydia.app. If they've installed Cydia, don't run because, it's jailbroken, right? So what you do is when they place a call to say, hey, do you have Cydia loaded, by looking for that file or that folder, you lie because they're not using the system library to check for that file, so that you tell the application, these aren't the droids you're looking for. And it'll say, no, Cydia isn't loaded, and the application's gonna go, cool, well then we're not jailbroken, I can go ahead and run. And so anything that the application can test for, you can lie to. If you don't think that's a bad thing, go watch The Matrix, right? everything you can do can be lied to. And so it's a nasty environment that you're writing applications for. So let's switch gears here and talk about hardening. There's a bunch of things that we can do. I'm going to step through each of these topics in the next half hour. And cover them and talk about what we can do there to make our applications reasonably secure. But always remember that perfection is not our target. If you're targeting perfection, you're not going to get there. Give up. If you're targeting pretty darn good, you can get there. The name of the game is to try to raise the cost of the attack. If you can raise the cost of the attack to where the adversary says, this isn't worth my effort, and they go to somebody else, you've won, right? However, if your application has such value that if I spend $1 million of time doing an attack for which I take home 10 million, then they might be willing to put in that effort, right? So think about that real carefully. That risk thing is something that your adversaries certainly think about. All right, so on the client side, user things, one thing that does help a lot is very strong passcodes on an individual device, I should say. If you're deploying your application to maybe an enterprise environment where all of your employees are running your application, there's a lot you can do to make sure that your applications run in a pretty safe space. You can force them to use MDMs, mobile device management systems, and you can do a pretty darn good job at making the clients reasonably trustworthy. If you're deploying an app through the app store and you're putting it in the hands of consumers, not so much. You can't force strong passcodes on them. In fact, you can't even detect if they're using a strong passcode. So when you're writing in your applications, you have to assume that your users, your consumers, are using four-digit PINs. Not only four-digit PINs, you have to assume that it's 1, 2, 3, 4. If you start with that assumption, that's how you have to write a secure application, all right? So that's a very limited path, but it is a path you can consider. Some of the architectural things that I want you to think about. This is, I believe that your architecture is where you can make the most impact on the security of a mobile application. This holds true for Android as well as for iOS. If you think secure architectures, think threat modeling. How many of you guys went through the Jim Del Grosso's threat modeling session? All right. If you're not threat modeling your mobile app, you're making a huge mistake. You need to think about all those assets in your application. You need to think about the controls, and you need to look at your threat model and make sure that you're not even considering putting those controls on the client side. And you try to avoid putting any sensitive assets out on the client. Your client really should be a presentation layer into your application. And you're probably thinking, well, that sounds like a web app. Why would I want to do that? Perfectly reasonable question. In a mobile application, you want to try to limit as much as you can the logic and the controls that are out on the client. Because as you've seen, you can't trust those. So keep the sensitive data off the client. Keep that on the server. Any sensitive functionality, like authenticators, don't put those out on the client. Have it as a presentation layer to your authenticator. Reasonable thing to do, but don't trust any control out on the client side. The client should just be simply an Objective-C version of a web app. And you can do that in web views even, but I prefer for it to be a native Objective-C app for the presentation layer. All right, so let's take those tips a little bit farther. excuse me. Some things that are useful, you can do obfuscation in your applications, and I've not looked into the code obfuscation in Objective-C, but I'll bet you there are tools that will do code obfuscation for you. For example, non-obvious names for your methods. And there are code obfuscators that I've seen, and some of you probably, I suspect, have done research and whatnot in this space. But you can, if you have an object that's going to do some authentication stuff, don't call it authenticator, right? Call it something completely different. And that raises the cost of analysis. It certainly doesn't make it unanalyzable, but it raises the cost a little bit. And the tools that obfuscate, so you can start with source code that's human readable and makes perfect sense, run it through an obfuscator, and now all your methods are just random strings. All your variables are just random strings. That's a reasonable thing to do to raise the cost of analysis up. But it adds another layer of complication on your side. Another reasonable thing to do is we can disable debugging, right? So in our main module, turn off debugging with the compiler switch. Turn off ptrace. That makes it very difficult to do things like with scrypt to grab a process. That process is resilient to being grabbed that way. It can still be done, but again, you're raising the cost, right? You're forcing your adversary to take that binary back to a different environment, like on their Mac, to do analysis of it. You can also complicate disassembly. We can use compiler optimization. We can strip all the symbols out of our application. These are standard C things that we've done for years. If you're shipping a commercial application that you've written in C, before you ship it, you're going to strip it, and you're going to take those symbol tables out to make it difficult for people to analyze. Instead of having address names in memory, you have hexadecimal memory addresses, and you're going to force them to figure them out, right? That raises the cost of analysis. It doesn't make it perfect. Next step, actually, that's on the server side. Actually, let me go back. Let me go back to this just a little bit more. There's a couple more things I want to say on this. In addition to stripping symbols out, you can statically link your libraries, right? So Instead of it being a dynamic library that your application calls, it's a statically linked library. Further, all of your system calls, instead of just statically linking them, which makes it more difficult to tamper with, you can also inline compile them. You know what that is? Where you take like a C library call to message send, and instead of calling that address, it actually puts those instructions into your application, which makes your application get a little bit bigger, but it forces your adversary to load it into a debugger and single step through it. That's the highest cost of reverse assembly that you can get to. It's still not perfect, but when you force your adversary to do that, they can't just set a breakpoint at the address for a library call now, because it's not an address anymore, it's part of your application. You can write your sensitive stuff in C, right? So still keep the sensitive stuff off of the client, but if you have to put anything remotely sensitive onto the client, code it in C, turn off debugging, statically link it, and inline compile it. Now your adversary is gonna have to single step through every line, every machine instruction in your application in order to analyze it. There aren't a lot of adversaries that are gonna spend that time and effort to do that. They exist, right? And if the pot of gold is big enough at the end of that rainbow, they're gonna do it. But you've forced them to do the most difficult process to analyze your application. Everybody follow that? Any questions on that? It sounds like a lot of work. I did talk about this just now, but it was compile inline, statically link, force your attacker to single step through. Don't give them information is what I'm saying here, right? So don't volunteer what you don't want them to know about. Force them to do it the hard way. Excuse me. Data that we use for our application. If you have to have data out on the client side, encrypt it, right? So I worry about lost and stolen devices. I worry about what's stored on the device. We have an API. Those of you that come to my build and break class for iOS tomorrow, we're gonna look at the file protection API, for example. You can take a file and you can set a protection category for it and it'll get encrypted. Use those things, right? You have actually some pretty darn powerful encryption tools available. If you're going to store data on a device, make sure it's pretty solidly encrypted. That ties back to how good your passcode is. And remember I said if you're running a consumer-facing app, assume that all of your users either have no password or have a password of 1234. Right? So if you can't trust the user's passcode, then use the Common Crypto Library. It's a primitive, very primitive crypto library, but you have all the AES functions, cipher blockchain, you name the AES function, you can get to it in the Common Crypto Library, and you can manually encrypt things using symmetric key. You've got to manage the key yourself, but you have those things available to you if you want to strongly encrypt data on an iPhone. Also enforce strong data wiping. When you've stored something in your application, if you need to remove it, wipe it. Because just like any file system, there's residue left behind. And if we're worried about forensic analysis of a lost or stolen or seized device, then you've got to wipe that data clean properly. And I'm kind of going down different paths here. This is a different sort of concern that I have rather than an adversary reverse engineering my application. But still, it's a concern. This is another little side tip also. Within SQLite, which is the standard SQL interface on iOS, everything in iOS, pretty much every application, all the Apple applications use SQLite for their data stores. When you remove a data element in SQLite, it actually remains in the file. It's actually kind of interesting to watch. So when you jailbreak a device, for example, your messages, your text messages, your SMSs get stored into a SQLite database. This is an interesting intellectual exercise that you can do for yourself on a jailbroken iPhone. send yourself a text message or send it or receive a text message on that device, and then using the Messages app, delete that text message so it looks like it's gone, and then copy that SQLite database over to your Mac. You will find the residue of that message, it's still there. So that, again, that's different than the reverse engineering concerns, but when you're thinking about hardening data, if your application is using a SQLite database, before you delete a piece of data in that SQL database, you want to overwrite it with null data and then delete it, because SQLite itself doesn't properly clean it. You know, these are simple little tips, but they matter. If you're putting sensitive stuff on a client side into this application, you've got big problems already. Don't give away those things by storing them insecurely. next step now. So I want to, actually, let me introduce a concept. I talked about this yesterday in my web app class, but the same thing holds true here in iOS. If I'm writing, say, a banking application, it's a sensitive application. We're going to be doing high-value transactions and whatnot on it. If somebody attacks me, I have three things that I want to be able to do. The first one is I want to prevent the attack from succeeding if possible, right? So that's just being able to call myself secure, tier one. Tier two is I want to be able to detect that I'm under attack. And I would like, in a perfect world, I'd like to be able to tell the good guys, hey guys, we're under attack over here. All right, help me. But I want to be able to tell the good guys we're under attack. That's not so easy in a mobile application, but in an ideal world, I'd like to be able to do that. Third one, and this one is a little bit more doable on a mobile application, I want to be able to take some evasive action. I'll talk about that one in just a second. But a business application, block the attack from succeeding, tell the good guys, be aware that we're under attack, tell the good guys that we're under attack, and take some evasive action. Those things matter hugely in a practical sense. So how do we detect if we're under attack? One of the things I want to look for is, are we running in a jailbroken environment? Apple used to have an API for detecting if your device is jailbroken from an application standpoint. So you sell your application through the Apple App Store, somebody installs it, you're running on some consumer's iPhone. When your application runs, check to see if it's in a jailbroken environment. If it is, stop doing what you're doing. As I said, this is not perfect, it's far from perfect, but there's a couple things that we can look for that may or may not tell us if we're running jailbroken. If they're there, we're certainly jailbroken. If they're not there, we might be jailbroken. So we can look at things like memory, runtime integrity checks, memory offsets of sensitive objects. So those are fairly static within your own application. Check to see if your own stuff is where you expect it to be, right? Yeah, marginally useful. You can check to see if the sandbox is working properly. Try to fork a process. One of the things that that happens in a non-jailbroken iPhone is processes can't fork in a traditional Unix sense. So call the C library fork function. Check to see if it works. If it works, you know you're jailbroken. If it comes back and says it didn't work, you might be jailbroken. But if it does work, you know it's on a jailbroken device. Check the size and checksum of the fstab file down in Etsy. You can, even though you're in a sandbox environment, you can only read and write in your own sandbox, you can read outside of the sandbox if you know where things are. And things like etc is in a static location. So read Etsy fstab and check to make sure it's the same on an iOS 9.2.1 machine. It should be the same on every iOS 9.2.1 machine. So you can check things like that to see if they're not been changed. look for symbolic links in the applications folder, right? That's a clear sign that somebody has installed something like Cydia or whatnot in there. Look for Cydia itself. Check to see if you have common jailbreak files in there. As I told you before, you can lie to your application and all these things might be false, but if it is there, it's guaranteed to be jailbroken. Then we can also consider honeypotting the application a little bit. Let's talk about that. So within my application, if I know that, again, I'm going to assume that it's something really sensitive like a banking application where I care if somebody's trying to tamper with me. I can deliberately create things in memory that look like enticing targets. All right? So this is taking us into the take evasive action realm. So if I put an object there called authenticator and give it a, this is a trivial example, but I have an object called authenticator. I'm going to put it in a Boolean field called authenticated. And I'm going to set it to be true, or I'm going to set it to be false. I'm going to do whatever with it, but I'm going to look for somebody to tamper with that, right? Because it's meaningless to me. I'm not actually using it for anything. See where I'm going with this? And by the way, if you're creating an object and not using it for anything, don't turn up optimization because it might get compiled out. But so keep your optimization low. Put an object in memory with an enticing name. Authenticator is just an example. But put objects out there as honeypots and look for people tampering with them. Things like Boolean fields are great to watch. So check to see if anybody's messing with them. And if somebody does tamper with them, you know that somebody's messing with your application. Even though you might think, I'm not running in a jailbroken environment, all of a sudden somebody goes and tampers with one of your objects in memory, you know that somebody is running in a jailbroken environment. And you can assume that there's a malicious user at the other end of the pipe. What do you do when you find that malicious user? That's driven by policy, right? So that's up to you. Some of the things you might want to think about, remote wipe the device. Lock the user account that's being used at the time. That user might be an innocent user who's just a victim of somebody else, but who knows? These are policy things, but think about them. Phone home. So I said you want to prevent the attack from succeeding. You want to detect the attack and tell the good guys. What about a quick post off to a system that you guys run that sends a help I'm being attacked message? Your attacker will see that happening, but it might be too late. So if you get that message, you know that Bob is logged in on that device and somebody's trying to attack you on that device back on the server side. There's a few things you can do. You can lock Bob's account. You can force Bob to change his password. You can take Bob's sensitive data and shunt it off somewhere else so nobody can get to it. Think about those things in terms of evasive reaction to somebody attacking you. I'm not trying to tell you what the right policy is. That's your decisions, obviously, to make. But those are the sorts of things you want to consider in a sensitive application. If you have, let's say, a banking application that you're putting out into the app store and putting into the hands of consumers, and there's hundreds of many, I shouldn't say hundreds, probably not, but many of them out there, you've got probably one of the most difficult software security challenges right now in the universe. Good luck with that. And I don't say that facetiously. You've got a significant challenge. If you've made an architectural mistake in how you built your application, you've got serious problems. Now, we talk about like container environments where we can run those applications. They're far from perfect too, and it just is another level of detail that your adversary has to dig through, but everything on that device down to the CPU, your attacker can get to, as you've mostly seen here. So, how confident do you guys feel now about applications on an iOS device? I want to emphasize, let me put this, this is that resource page again. I'm not trying to tell you don't do it. I'm trying to tell you write those applications, put those business applications there, but go into it with your eyes wide open and understanding what the problems are. We all take risks every day. We drive to work, we do whatever. There's risks out there in the world. We accept those risks in a business environment and we get on with business anyway. Same thing holds true with our applications on our mobile devices. There's serious problems on iOS as well as Android, and we've got to do business anyway. So put those preventions in there. Make sure our applications are as difficult to tamper with as you can make them. Think about all those things with dynamic libraries, with statically linking, with inline compiling, all that stuff. They make a difference to your application's security. In the end, it's still going to do the same functionality, but you've raised the price, the cost of your adversaries taking them apart. So questions, comments, what do you guys think? Have I painted the picture too gloom and doomy, or do you think this is realistic? Yes, sir.
I have a question. At our company, they are using Citrix whatever stuff with the mobile device management.
Mm-hmm.
What's the difference if the application is deployed inside that kind of secure container,
yeah,
like they said, in comparison with an application deployed the standard way?
Yeah, so that is a really good question, and I just kind of touched on it here. If you're running in an MDM container environment, whether it's Citrix or Good or any of those players out there, that's better, but it's for enterprise deployments for employees, right?
Yep.
So, but it's a level, it's another layer of obfuscation. Can you get inside those container environments? Well, of course you can, but you're raising the bar of difficulty. So is it good? Yeah. Is it better than just putting an application from the app store on the device? Yeah. Is it perfect? No. One of my longtime sayings in the world of security is, it's an Americanism, of course, but there ain't a horse that can't be rode or a man that can't be throwed, which basically means that there's no such thing as perfect. Whatever defenses you can come up with, somebody can get around them. Especially when you own the device, you can run debuggers on the device down to the CPU machine level. You can do anything you want on that device you own. Those container environments are excellent. I have no problem with them at all, especially for employee-facing applications, but they can still get into them. So it's better, but it's not perfect. Any other questions, comments? Yes, sir.
I don't mean it in a bad way, but is it common that the debugger is on? That, I suppose the default in the apps is that you can't attach a debugger to it?
It's not the default. If you just take Xcode and write yourself a Hello World app, there's nothing that Xcode does by default to turn off debugging, right? So I can debug iGoat here, and I've done nothing there to change it, right? So you have to, as the developer, you have to turn it off yourself. And then your app won't be able to be trivially debugged. It still isn't perfect though. But so yes, the default is go ahead and debug. Is that crazy? Yeah, but you in an enterprise environment or even in a professional software development environment, you probably have a set of default compiler switches and stuff that you're going to use for all of your applications. Turning off debugging should be one of them. So in your world, you should be producing applications that their defaults are always no debugging. Any other questions?
Are there any well-known cases where a company got in trouble?
Are there well-known cases where companies got in trouble? We have had applications that have been reverse engineered and people have found big vulnerabilities in them many times. The weaknesses that we've found in iOS applications typically haven't been deliberate malicious applications. It's not malware. We're finding flaws in applications and people are doing that constantly. I've done reviews for my clients where I have done this sort of analysis on their applications and I've found weaknesses in them. Those tend to be private conversations between a contractor and an employer, but have there been any that have been publicly disclosed? I don't know how the analysis was done, but I'm going to say about 3 years ago, there was a big application weakness discovered on a Citibank application that made the news, made the media. Citibank, of course, quickly fixed it. Did the person who found that, did they find it using techniques like what I'm talking about? I don't know the answer. Is it feasible they did it this way? Absolutely. At least ever since Jarsky came out with his book, where he discusses these different attacks that I've been talking about, that came out in 2012. And now this book was released in January of this year. Everything I've talked about, they go through with screenshot examples one after the other in this book. So you have to assume that that's what your adversaries are going to do. So can I cite specific cases where this absolutely was done? No. Is it likely that it's done? Absolutely. I consider the likelihood to be 1.0. Other questions? Cool, then it's coffee break time. Thanks for coming. Hope you've got some value out of this. I hope nobody here is too scared to write an iOS application because you shouldn't be.